Neuroplasticity is the idea that the brain is capable of changing throughout one's life, and this idea has been applied to substance abuse disorder to help explain addiction and relapses. However, the idea of neuroplasticity has seldom been applied to recovery. So, today, on Brief Brain Facts, we discuss if there's any merit to the phrase, once an addict, always an addict, or if there's a way to fully recover from changes to the brain brought about by drug and alcohol abuse and dependence. The mid-1990s saw a change in the way many viewed addiction. Specifically, there was a push away from the weakness of the individual as a reason for alcohol and drug addiction, and a push towards the idea that addiction was a chronic brain disease. Current proponents of this model argue that it explains the potential for relapse, or returning to drug and alcohol use after an extended period of abstinence. This model accounts for changes to the brain due to substance abuse and dependence. According to researchers, studies have consistently shown cellular and functional neuroplastic changes to the brain that are generated by continued drug exposure. Neuroplasticity is the concept that the brain can change through life experiences. This approach would not only mean that experience accounts for addiction, but also neuroplasticity could result in full cognitive recovery of lost functioning brought about by damage to areas of the brain as a result from drug use. Neuroplasticity occurs often naturally through learning. Additionally, it may manifest in cases where injury to the brain has been sustained, as cortical areas are then rewired in order to account for functional losses. It also may take place at the cellular level, whereby reinforcing a particular skill, thought, or behavior strengthens connections between neurons, resulting in fundamental change between how effectively brain cells communicate. It can also work in an opposite manner, the if you don't use it, you lose it principle. This neuroplastic change may account for why you may not remember the Pythagorean theorem or how to say or write close the door in Latin. As mentioned, the brain plays an integral role in addiction and recovery. However, the prevalent school of thought is that sustained drug and alcohol abuse and dependence results in irreparable harm to certain areas of the brain, depending upon the substance used. As an example, researchers have discovered via brain imaging studies that capture images of the brain through direct or indirect means, that chronic alcoholism results in damage to the cerebellum, an area of the brain responsible for intentional movement and coordination. In addition, atrophy or death of brain cells was seen in the prefrontal cortex, an area of the brain responsible for things like judgment, planning, and decision making. This has led to a host of fundamental impairments ranging from attention deficits to impairments in memory. Alcohol isn't the only substance that has resulted in similar findings and impairments. Importantly, once damage has been sustained, can this impact full functional recovery, and is the brain capable of repairing itself after prolonged abstinence or a prolonged period of time without the substance being introduced to the system? If we approach recovery from a neuroplastic viewpoint, the brain is capable of change, and we should expect full functional and neuronal recovery once the abused substance is no longer in the systems for a substantial period of time. Unfortunately, the results are mixed. Going back to studies involving chronic alcoholism, in some cases, full improvement has been seen in the prefrontal cortex, while irreversible damage to the hippocampus, an area responsible for memory, were also seen. More troubling, improvements made to areas of the brain have not always accompanied cognitive improvements. So while certain improvements in impulse control were seen, only partial recovery in things like memory were noted. Researchers found that in the case of cocaine dependence, while working memory improved with sustained abstinence, impairments in attention remained. Sustained issues with decision-making remained in cases of opioid abuse and dependence. These findings are troubling, since researchers note that diminished and sustained neurocognitive deficits is a primary factor in relapses. However, the aforementioned findings, while found in the presence of current treatment options, were noted in the absence of specific targeted neurocognitive training, meaning that while these findings were in the presence of complete and total abstinence from the abused substance, the treatment did not involve specialized training to help combat or improve cognitive deficits, which is good news. You see, these former addicts did make great improvements in both cognitive deficits and structural brain improvements were achieved, without specific targeting of affected areas. Thus, researchers are beginning to see the benefits of having a brain that is susceptible to change, but this benefit has yet to be realized in general for addiction treatment and therapy. Researchers argue that while cognitive training is a novel concept in addiction therapy, it could more accurately target the affected brain areas by not only repairing the regions, but also repairing previously lost cognitive functions. Thus, an addict may not always be an addict once a personalized treatment option is successfully applied. Was there anything in this episode of Brief Brain Facts that you found particularly informative? If so, comment below. If you liked what you saw, please subscribe to our channel and make sure to hit that like button. As always, thank you for watching.